Yeah, first, many thanks to Karen and Eric for first for inviting, well, no, for organizing this event in three different versions. And okay, no, I think it's a good compromise. It really works well. Then thanks for the invitation to speak here. It's a great honor for me. And as many other speakers, I will go back to history, to March 98. I just arrived at CPT Marseille at that time as a postdoc, and then a larger group of us went to a conference on non-computational geometry in Vitry sul Mare in south of Italy. And of course, there was a contribution by Alain Cohn, and Alain reported on really fascinating, groundbreaking work by physicist Dirk Reimer. Who discovered that randomization confusion theory, which was, well, a mystery for many mathematicians, is actually encoded in Hopf algebra. So this was absolutely remarkable, and even more remarkably is that the same Hopf algebra in a slightly different flavor appears in another work, what Alain was doing with Henri Moscovici, on the local index formula for, well, certain hyperelliptic operators on space of foliations. So of course we didn't understand immediately all the details, but it was clear to everyone that this is absolutely great development, and we have to understand it. So it had enormous impact to our group in Marseille. So we had seminars on it. We stopped all other work and wanted to understand it. So, okay, I work with Thomas Krivsky, our next speaker on this, and we soon understood so the generic structure, but we had problems with overlapping divergences. Okay, I think it was Bruno Jucum who invited Dirk to Marseille for the end of May, and as preparation for discussion, Thomas and I made our notes available on archive. And well, okay, here that's more or less the first part of our paper. And I want to highlight one sentence, which is the result already of discussion with Dirk. So here we describe how Dirk treats overlapping divergences. And there's a story behind this little sentence. The story is more or less this. So I found on an old computer my email correspondence with Dirk. So this Dirk's message from May 98. And so, okay, he explains what to do. And what I want to emphasize is here that so he points out that to understand overlapping divergences, it's assumed that the reader digested the use of Schwinger-Dyson equation. And he refers then to the habilitation thesis where, okay, details can be found. All right, so I stop history here at this point because I discontinued working on the Hopf algebra. There are other speakers who can do this much better than I can. But so for me, these Dyson-Schwinger equations, they are of absolute central importance. Back in 98, it was new for me, but in the meantime, they really become, I would say, my most important tool. So, and then I would like to show this impressive page. There's an impressive number of 11 papers authored by Dirk, which have Dyson-Schwinger equation in the title, so just in title. So I'm sure there are many, many more where Dyson-Schwinger equations are the main or one main subject, but already in title there are 11 papers, so three with Karen, but many, many more. So, okay, therefore, I think contributing something on Dyson-Schwinger equations is something well suited for this nice workshop. Okay, one can say really a lot about Dyson-Schwinger equations. We can lecture series and so on. So I will be very short and give some general idea, and then we go to a specific instance. So Dyson-Schwing equations are some equations of motions for green function and quantum field theory. One can, and it's also good to do this, one can understand them graphically as a collection of Feynman-Graph series of same external structure. So they form blobs, and the equations are of that type. So for instance, one is interested in a connected two-point function, and then one follows here the first line on the left, what can happen? So either a line goes through, nothing happens, that's the free theory, or it hits somewhere a vertex. So then you write the vertex, and then you ask what else can there be? So in this case, it will be a connected four-point function, which then, which will happen. So, this picture is very easy to understand when collecting Feynman graphs. But the point is, somehow this assumes that the series of Feynman graphs converges, which is absolutely not clear. So, but there's another remark. So such an equation can be completely rigorously be derived without any reference to perturbation theory. So that's an exact equation, which can be solved by perturbation theory, but it's not needed. So therefore, in fact, these Dyson-Schwing equations are non-perturbative equations. The problem is it's always, sometimes, often, whatever, hard to solve it. And the problem you see already here in the structure, so you want to know something on the two-point function, that's what you want to study, but this equation involves here the four-point function. So and that's a typical feature that somehow you need to information which you do not have yet. So either one has to solve all these equations simultaneously, which of course is difficult, or one has to work. So, and I'm working in particular on quantum field theories on finite dimension approximations of non-Hilbert geometries. Another word is matrix model. So in this setting, it happens that these equations somehow disentangle. So we get equations where, okay, this relation sign is reversed. So we are interested in endpoint function, and then we only need functions where the number of legs is smaller, not larger than n. So the price to pay is that this equation become nonlinear, and that's also difficult. All right. So okay, now I come to the subject von free theories of particular type on matrices. So all right. So starting point is fundamental theorem in harmonic analysis, Dudu Bochner. Who proved that whenever we have an inner product on a real vector space, so finite dimensional for simplicity, for instance, the space of self-adjoint n by n matrices. Okay, so it's strange. The theorem is whenever you have an inner product on such space, then there is a unique probability measure on the dual space whose Fourier transform is x of minus 1/2 the inner product. It's completely general. So we take a very specific inner product on space of matrices. Namely, we give ourselves n positive real numbers, e1 to en. So they somehow stand for the energies or the spectrum of Laplace operator truncated to n levels. So when we build a scalar product, well, this one, KL and prime LK divided by EK plus EL. So that's gives a inner product, and okay, we take this one. So as I said, it has something to do with Laplacians on number geometries. And here that's a sort of Gaussian measure, and everything is known, of course. Okay, we will not stop here, so we for the next step, and Also next step will explain why we are interested in this particular inner product. So, okay, the reason for choosing this inner product is the Concevich model. So the Concevich model is a deformation of the measure I just introduced for the free theory by a cubic potential. So e to the minus lambda n. Discovered that, okay, if you do well computations with this particular measure, so vacuum graphs, and you understand them as function here of these spectral values E1 up to N, then this gives rise to well, the numbers which you get, rational numbers, they are in fact intersection numbers of tautological correctness classes on the modal space of complex curves. So it's a very deep result. And so there are many, many developments connected to this result, among others. So it's an integrable model related to the KdB hierarchy. So in fact, all these relations were already suggested by Witten shortly before, and Concevich gave the proof by inventing this particular measure. But actually, it's of course not a real measure. As you know, phi cube is unbounded below, so you better have lambda purely imaginary, and then it's not a measure, but formally it is. So, okay, and it's connected to something which is very fashionable now, topological recursion, also talked by Thomas, will deal with it, and so on. Okay, so, and okay, this everything is known. So we are interested in a deformation by a quartic potential, so phi to the 4 instead of phi cube. This is a very small step from point of view of quantum field theory, and very natural step. Lambda phi to the 4 is much more natural than lambda phi cube. But the mathematics is completely different. So there is a clear logic why Concevich chose phi to phi cube. Namely, phi cube has something to do with simple zeros of Strebe differential on Riemann surface. And you cannot replace it by phi to the 4, which would be quadratic zeros, and but these are exceptional. So the generic case is really phi to the cube, and there's absolutely no relation mathematically between phi cube and phi to the 4. Also, perturbation theory is completely different. It turns out, however, that that's a recent result of the previous year, that nevertheless, we find structures which are completely similar. Mathematical structures has something to do with topological recursion. And well, this is the subject of the talk. So, but one remark, we get something for quantum field theory. So it's a toy model, all right, but it's something where we have really exact solution, exact in the coupling constant. So, okay, yeah, that's the contents. Okay, so let's start. Starting point, well, is we will derive Dyson-Schwinger equations. So we consider now the full transform of the measure, and that's the full measure. So depending on the spectral values E1 to E up to N, and the coupling constant. So that's the quartic deformation. So then it's a completely elementary exercise to derive these equations of motions for the Fourier transform. So, and these are important because if you remember, I try to go back to the picture, but so, okay, these external legs, in this formulation result by differentiating the Fourier transform with respect to the source matrix. So if I have n derivatives, then I get n external legs. So, right. So a derivative with respect to m brings the phi downstairs, and then, okay. Okay, graphically, this is the endpoint function. All right, so, and the problem is then in this equation, we have too many external legs, and these equations help us because they allow to express here a second derivative, so which gives two additional legs, second derivative of the Fourier transform, by something which has only one leg, or in this case, no leg at all. So, okay, we can express these derivatives by something which has less derivatives, or maybe the same number, but okay, that's the key point, which is not available in Jouville Confit theory, that's special for matrix models. And that's the key why we can go much further than for normal Confit theories. Good. Right, so I will show some of these equations then which result. So the idea is you differentiate some more times and then you get identities, and these identities are the Dyson-Schwinger equations. Okay, so these Dyson-Schwinger equations, they inherit these matrix indices. So these are matrix indices, of course, and then we have a finite number distinguished by a finite number of matrix indices of these equations. So there's a key step, namely it turns out that one can complexify the resulting Dyson-Schwinger equations so that they become equations between mirror morphic functions in many complex variables. Of course, complexifying finite number of, they're given by a finite number of points, and complexifying them, it's not unique, but there's a natural way to do it. So we want to stress that there's a very natural way to obtain Dyson-Schwinger equations for mirror morphic functions. And then we can use the whole power of complex analysis to tackle and to solve them. So in doing this, so after complex equation, we can relax a little bit the condition that these E1 up to N were previously degenerate. So we can admit multiplicities, so our different eigenvalues or spectral values are little e1 up to ed, and they come with a certain multiplicity. It's not really important, but it gives us a lot of flexibility. Okay, right. So here is the simplest or the first equation which one gets. So we consider here the second moment of the measure with the two-point function. All right, there are certain factors of n. We give it a name, g, with two indices. Okay, if b is different from q, no, so that's okay. But here's something else, then it's zero in the measure. So that's the interesting object to study. We're interested in large n expansion. So this is a formal power series in inverse powers of n. Turns out it goes in even steps. And the little number g, the parameter, is or will be related to the genus of a Riemann surface. So that's it. But okay, here it's just a name. But there's this formal expansion. So as I said, we complexify, so here everything is discrete, we complexify it, so we arrange that our g, pq, is actually the evaluation of a mirror morphic function in two complex variables, xi and eta, no, theta and eta, where theta is ep, this was too fast, and eta is eq. So these initial spectral values, if we evaluate our mirror morphic function on them, we get back this, the expanding coefficients. So, and the first equation is this one. So it has a long history, obtained with Hart-Gosse many, many years ago. So important thing is that's an equation which only involves this two-point function, complexified two-point function. So that's nice to have, but as I said, the price is it's a nonlinear equation. So here is the nonlinearity, which was really hard to understand and to solve. So it's a very general setting. So if we go to the large n limit, then we could have divergence. So better have bare mass and the wave function optimization there to have a lot of freedom. Well, for me, the breakthrough was in joint work with Eric, which we achieved during a school in Lesouches, organized by Dirk 2 years ago, where we were able to solve this equation, Donner equation, in a special case, namely that the multiplicity is one, and all these spectral values are equally spaced. So this is a particular choice, which corresponds exactly to the lambda for the four model or two-dimensional Moyal space. So there's a particular interest studying this, this choice in large element. So it turned out that doing this, so all these sums become integrals and so on. And then, okay, you do perturbation theory, not for this equation, but okay, for some auxiliary equation. And remarkably, using Eric's hyperend program, pushing far enough, we understood the first coefficients. So they had a remarkable pattern. And we understood then that they are the first terms of a series, which is the series of the Lambert function, Lambert W function. Okay, so, well, that's something. Solving such a nonlinear equation to Lambert W was, okay, unexpected, and this opened the way. So it opened the door to tackle the general case. So the Lambert function has special properties, and after understanding them, which took some time, we understood the general case. So take general E case, general R case, finite or infinite, whatever, we can solve in any case this equation. So of particular interest is the four-dimensional Moyal space, where we get, instead of Lambert function, we get the inverse function of the hypergeometric function. So this will be covered in the overnext talk by Alex Hock, 1550 in Paris time. So he will present more details on this approach and very nice consequences of this example. Good, so I continue with the discrete case because here for finite D or finite N, there are extremely nice structures which appear, which has something to do with complex analysis and algebraic geometry. All right, so it has also a long history, but I will just give the final theory. So I will describe the solution of this equation in complete generality in case of finite N, finite D. So you have to do something. Okay. Remember, we are given the spectral values EK, multiplicities, and coupling constant. So define new parameters, epsilon k, rho k, which somehow deform from these data in the following way. So build such a function R of z minus lambda divided by n. Okay, this finite sum. So here you should see in a certain regime, this will produce a logarithm. And that's z plus lambda log z is then, okay, the inverse function is Lambert function. So there's a logic behind this, which can be guessed from the Lambert function. All right, so take this problem, function R, and okay, here you have epsilon k, rho k, and they are implicitly defined to satisfy R of epsilon k is EK, and R prime epsilon k, rho k is RK. So that's an implicitly defined problem. So then, remember this was the function we want to have, so which solves this equation, hopefully. So you go to the pre-image. So zeta and eta are given, and then you go to the pre-image via R, so z and w, and you transform variables, and after transformation, the result is script g. So for this function script g, we have a formula. So here it is. So it's, it's a rational function, that's important. And it involves the definition of R, and so R of Z can be replaced by zeta. That's clear, but the point is we also have the negative R of minus W, R of minus Z, where we cannot do directly. So there's no direct relation, so we have to go via R. So R is important. Then notation, there's a little head. So head means, okay, first go back here. It's, well, you see, this is a rational function, which is the ratio of a polynomial of degree d plus one by polynomial degree d. So there are d plus one preimages of every value, and the other preimages except of the principal one, they carry head. So these epsilon k hat are then the pre-images of these deformed energies. Okay, so that's the solution. And so proving it when one knows what to do is very, very easy. So that's, you can give it as an exercise in a complex analysis course. But it really took us 10 years to come from this equation to the solution. So, okay, remark, symmetry, although it is not manifest, it is automatic, it can be checked. And yeah, okay, that's remark, not support. Good. More remarks. So again, I stress, that's the solution of nonlinear Dyson-Schwinger equation. We found it first with Eric by, well, brute force, I would say, perturbation theory, and a lot of luck that we understood what we were computing there. And but then we proved it. So we got an idea, and then the proof is beautiful. It's beautiful complex analysis. So and then, of course, you ask, how is this possible that you solve a nonlinear problem? And it's more or less clear there must be something behind, so some deep algebraic structure, which we don't have it, but we are confident to find it. And this involves the affine equation, which I will then talk next. Okay, one remark. It was very important to deform the data. So originally we had EKs with multiplicity, lambda, and in these variables, you don't see anything. It's absolutely important to transform by the inverse of such a relatively simple function. Then we see a structure. And okay, it's an empty statement, but nevertheless, maybe one should think about maybe something similar could be true also in familiar quantum theories, that we have to transform in a way which we do not know to other variables. And in these other variables, we see more structure. Okay, but I have no idea how to do it in nice examples. Okay, so now I come to the affine equations. By general theory, by analysis, it's clear they are solvable, but there doesn't seem to exist any theory which could give us this equation explicitly. So the key idea was due to Alex. So he suggested to look at auxiliary functions. So namely, so here, these are our two-point functions. They somehow depend implicitly on the initial data, the energies and the coupling constant. And so you differentiate these two-point functions with respect to the energies. Of course, you can do this in practice because we don't control the measure. But okay, let's introduce them and call them omega with indices A1 up to N, which, okay, A1 special and the others are derivatives. And then again, apply these genus expansions. Okay, so, and the key step is we don't need to know here the two-point function. We can derive Dyson-Schwinger equation directly for these omega n's. Well, not directly, they are coupled to other functions, which I will introduce. And then we can try to solve it. So what we need are the initial data, our rational function R and the planar two-point function, but nothing else. Everything else is contained in Dyson-Schwinger equations. So the for me at least, completely unexpected result was that these auxiliary functions unexpectedly translate to something which has a clear mathematical meaning, namely they are object of block topology recursion proposed by Bourreau and Chardrin 5 years ago. So I will say a little bit on this. Okay, here that's a, more or less the an overview what one has to do. So it's not, we are interested in these omegas. So from them we later get then the moments here, these which we want to have. So okay, they were auxiliary functions, but we have to introduce more auxiliary functions, namely t's, two sorts of them. And then one has to go through such a triangular pattern. So here this first box is what we know, the two-point function, Planck two-point function. And then, okay, for genus zero, it's enough to compute this chain in the upper line. But if we want to increase the genus, then we also need here this strange other function. And then, well, you won't go here, then, you, okay, this is the way to go. Okay, so, okay, these, for all these functions, we have Dyson-Schwinger equations. And so evaluating the t's is relatively easy, but the result is horribly complicated. And you insert this horrible result into the equation for the omegas, and then many, many cancellations arise. And finally, the outcome for the omegas is extremely easy. So I will only show the results, not the equation and not the way to compute it. So first result is well, marked points, omega 0,2. So of interest is this expression here in parentheses, especially the red one. So this is, well, okay, up to differentials is the Bergmann kernel of topological recursion. So having found this, we knew that we are on the right way. So, and there are always these prefactors. So the idea is we multiply by the differential of R and any of these variables, also lambda goes away, and then we come to differential forms. So one form in each variable. And so, okay, well, that's, so we know it's true in the planar case, otherwise it's conjectured. We are sure that these omega gn's have a very simple pole structure. So they are meromorphic. And we think we know where the poles are. So we are sure in planar case, but otherwise it's conjectured. So they have only poles at zero on the opposite diagonal and on special points, there are 2D of them, where the derivative of R vanishes. So these are the so-called ramification points of the ramified cover encoded in this rational function R. Good, yeah, okay. So mark these T's, T functions, they are much more complicated. They have many, many more poles. Okay, so here's the, so yeah, few solutions. It looks also complicated, but in fact, there is a clear logic, and in fact, these are relatively simple functions. Maybe I wanted to show, maybe show first this. Okay. So these are non-perturbative results. So that's important. In principle, you can amuse yourselves and finding which Feynman graphs, series of Feynman graphs, contribute to such an omega GM. Of course, there are infinitely many of them. And so the sum is convergent. And so there are certain graphs of a certain external structure, certain topology, and well, all they sum to such an expression. And of course, the dependence on the coupling constant is a little bit hidden. So, well, remember, we had the system of equations, the epsilon case and the rho case, they're implicitly defined. And then we have the betas, the solution of R prime beta equals zero. And well, this system has to be solved somehow by the implicit function theorem. So abstractly, it's completely clear. We have a holomorphic solution. And also, as you know, we have good convergence results if one wants to find a solution numerically. But one can also approach them via a Taylor expansion to the implicit function theorem. And then this Taylor approach will coincide with the Feynman-Graph expansion of a certain topology and external structure. So our idea is that this is something which we would like to contribute to this sigma volume for Dirk's birthday. It's really nice to compare the Feynman-Graph series with the exact result, going in particular through these ramification points. So a few remarks on color code. On the next two pages, I will show that the terms in blue have a very clear mathematical meaning. So there's something very well known. So in particular here, you see these rational numbers appearing. At least some of them have a meaning as intersection numbers of characteristic classes on the moduli space of curves. Not all of them, but many of them. So and then here this term in black with poles on the opposite diagonal, we understand them at least for all planar functions, so genus zero, conjectured, but it's clear it's true. And so we are confident that very soon we will understand them completely. So my feeling is that they are just there for quantum field theory, but maybe they will not have a meaning in mathematics. But these terms here in red, poles at zero, because zero is special. So you remember we had always this reflection z goes to minus z, also here, beta minus beta. This is very special for this particular model. And zero is the fixed point of this reflection. And these numbers, 1,8, 1,16, and so in particular, these combinations of ratios of derivatives of r is zero. So my feeling is they have a certain meaning. And so there's something which will extend the result of Concevich to something, but I have no idea to what. That's for the future. So, okay, now what are the blue terms? So, so here there's a general picture of the ramification points. Of course, I can only draw a real picture. So, if there are simple zeros, then the real behavior is just a z square function. And then you have z, and the reflection is called sigma of z. So, means r of z is r of sigma, I of z, and at beta I, the two come together. Good. So this reflection is the local Galois involution. Good. So, okay, now you do the following. Omega 0, 1 is special. So you define it as minus r of minus z, r prime of z dz. So, and all other omega gn as I had before. And then, well, surprisingly, but there will be some origin, we have so-called loop equations. So, okay, these omega gn, they have poles very of high order at beta, but if we sum the contribution at z and at sigma of z, the reflect value, then the poles cancel and we get something, also constant term vanishes, so it's something which starts linearly about the ramification point. And then there's a quadratic loop equation that, it's a very strange combination. So you take omega, one genus lower, insert z and sigma of z, and then you share it in product, quadratic, and you share z and sigma of z in both variables, and otherwise you distribute the other variables and the genus. And then, these are poles of high orders, but in this particular combination, all the poles cancel, also linear term cancels, and we get something, a quadratic form in Z, which starts quadratically about the pole. So, okay, this is true in planar case up to 5 and also for 1,1. And of course, we conjecture this can be an accident that all these poles cancel, so this should be true in general. So then there's a general theorem of block topology recursion, that whenever you have a family of differential forms, meromorphic, which satisfy these abstract-loop equations, then you know what is the polar part. So polar part, part of this omega GM with poles at the ramification points. And this part is given by such a formula. Okay, looks complicated, but anyway, but this is familiar. So that's the famous formula of topological recursion. And so in the original version of topological recursion, it was just this. So that's the formula how you build from. So here on the right, everything is known. So you want to compute omega GM, and all the others are already known, you have them. And all you have to do is to evaluate just this residue, and okay, here's a certain recursion kernel, was the Bergmann kernel integrated, omega 0, 1 are given, and so on. So this is something easy. And the remarkable thing is that many, many structures in mathematics follow exactly this formula. So, In large class examples, PZ omega is equal to omega. So you can remove this P. There are no other poles. But as proved by Bohr and Chardrin, that's not the general case. So when you only require these abstract loop equations, then you can afford more. And then these formally describe the polar part. And then there's something else. H, the holomorphic part, holomorphic at ramification points. And they, okay, they are formed by these blobs. So additional input. So here's a picture. So that's the picture of topological recursion. That, so okay, we live here on space of lines, compactified complex lines to mark points on a Riemann surface. And so, well, and you want to build such a particular form on that space. And the idea is you distribute lines and genera in all possible ways. And then you glue everything with the recursion kernel. So that's standard topological recursion. And in the blob case, there is an additional input at every recursion step. So yeah, important point is that's an infinite dimensional space. But our omega GN select one particular point in this space. And the question is, what's the significance? Okay, good. Yeah, it's a sort of outlook, whatever. So it is known from the paper that whenever we have these abstract loop equations, then these omega GM encode intersection numbers on the modular space of stable complex graphs. That's a general fact. So, and they give formula. So more or less the idea is we get in general several copies of the same intersections of the psi and kappa classes. So psi are Chern classes, kappa are Mumford classes, as in the Concevich model. And but they are not independent, they are coupled somehow or described, well, they give a precise description via the blobs. It's completely generic. So, so any case, one gets something, but it's not clear that this is of interest. So here, but in our case, we have this global involution, that to minus set, which plays a special role. So that, let's hope, it's not proved. But I hope that at least these poles about zero could have some meaning in mathematics. We do not know what, but it could be something. So this global involution as an addition structure on the modular space of curves. So another thing is, so we have endpoint functions here, forms. We don't have the partition function itself. At some point, we would like to identify it. And then the interesting question is whether this partition function is a Torr function for a Hirota equation. So if so, this would be a precise formulation of integrability. So in general topological recursion, there's always this relation. There's always a Torr function. For blob topological recursion, this is not known. So it could also be not the case. So there's something which one should decide. Okay, I think I'm time. All right, so summary. Was talk on Dyson Schwinger equations, and it arches from the Hopf-Weil-Feynman graphs, where it's the tool to disentangle the problem of overlap divergences. Two things what I presented. So Dyson Schwinger equations are central to Dirk and to me. And at least I tried to convince you that Dyson-Schwinger equations are really, I would say, the best approach to study quantum field theory non-perturbatively. So in this particular case of matrix models, quantum fields on open spaces, they produce a complete understanding. And I'm sure, but I can prove it, that also other quantum field theories should be treated in this way. So, brings me to an end to Dirk. So, I wish you a lot of pleasure and success with your work on Dyson-Schwinger equations, also everything else, and happy birthday.
Thank you very much, Reimer.
So, I have a question for Reimer.
Yeah, all right.
So, what would be your advice? How to use topological or blob topological recursion when I want to go from solvable to true quantum field theory Dyson-Schwinger equations?
Well, this, I would say this relation is very special. So I'm sure there's some integrability and you cannot expect this for normal quantum field theories. But I'm sure that the idea to disentangle the problem, when you have a quantum field theory that you split, somehow understand it as the convolution of a function with the inverse of another function.
Yep.
Part of the difficulty you throw in this problem of determining the inverse. So we have seen for the Lambert function, expanded gives all the gift logarithms, integrals then the Nielsen pole logarithm and so on. And it's the inverse of a very, very simple function. So and I'm sure something in this direction should be there also in other quantum field theories. Topological recursion, I'm not sure.
Well, I have Gaetan Boron now sitting next to me, so I can actually try to get something from him. But...
Okay. Yeah,
it's nice that you hired him. Yeah. Okay. It's amazing. Yep. Thanks.
If there are further questions, feel free to raise your hand if you're a viewer or just speak up as a speaker. I had a question when you showed your formula for the, I mean, these omega GMs, they're all, everything's rational, right? There's no transcendental numbers in these things.
This one?
Yeah. Yeah, so I was just confused because if I remember, at some point, as you just mentioned, there are transcendental things, right? There's logarithms and maybe some zeta values or polylogarithms.
Ah, good point, yeah.
And you said you can somehow match some classes of Feynman diagrams to these individual omegas. Then I just wonder, where do the transcendentals go?
Well, so to do this... Well, that's a toy model, quantum field theory, there's no randomization. Everything is it's a regularization. So everything is fine dimensional. For quantum field theory, you have to go to the large N limit, N to infinity, D to infinity in a certain way. And this produces here integrals. And in the case which we had, this was the logarithm. You almost see it here, that this converges to a logarithm. In other cases, so that will be the presentation by Alex in 1 hour or so, this will be a hypergeometric function. And then you have to produce the inverse. You see it somewhere here after this transformation. And even if you have a very simple integral here, for instance, the inverse of the hypergeometric function, it's not clear to me that of course it exists, it's a monotonous function, so it must have an inverse, but what it is, it's not clear. You expand it and you get all the hyperlogarithms. Yeah. So there's a step which is hidden here. So I described the fine dimension case. For quantum field, we want to have the large N limit.
Yeah, Thank you very much. That's very clear. All right. As I suggest, we thank Raimar again for his nice talk.